Hello, colleagues. This is DeRionne. I'm greeting you on the Friday before classes start. This Friday, when we're probably in a frenetic pace, getting ready for the thousands of students that we'll be serving this semester, as we do each and every year. Clearly recognize this is a different environment, as most of us are doing our work from home, but knowing that our mission is probably more relevant now than ever. I hope that you enjoyed our professional week activities and all of the wonderful panelists and speakers that we had. I found the student panel to be truly one that left me thinking for some time about how we think about race and racism, how that impacts the classroom. And I heard tremendous feedback regarding the faculty panel as well. So I want to congratulate each of you and thank our speakers who came, including Dr. Sarah Gojic-Robb from the Hope Institute, who talked to us quite a bit about basic needs and security and how we think differently about what our students need in this particular moment. She lifted up the idea of how data is so important and to hear students' experiences to make decisions around those things as well, and how we use data to inform change, change within an organization and hopefully serve those students more effectively. So we're doing that right now in several areas of the college right now. First, when it comes to health and safety, our Corona advisory team is doing such a phenomenal job at the organization, looking at trends and data. They're helping us to understand more deeply what the impacts are within the organization, advising us on testing and vaccine availability, and more importantly, helping us make decisions as an organization about how we serve our students and our employees most effectively. Our public safety and facilities teams have been looking at this data for months and how to create access opportunities for so many people who need to come on our campuses to complete coursework or to do the basic work of the institution. Our mission of protecting our students' academic progress during this time is really one of the forefront issues that we have to think about. The decision to offer more 7-week classes in the spring and fewer 15-week classes was based entirely on research and data. We saw a trend in enrollment picking up considerably in the summer, and many of us were wondering what was at the root of that. And you look at that, in the summer we deliver primarily short-term 7-week courses. But what's very interesting, we also saw the same trend in the fall, that the courses that were filling up first were those shorter 7-week courses. More students were registering for more compacted learning experiences. Now, there's several factors, I think, at work that are playing into this moment for us. We know that student employment is indeed a significant one, both in terms of paying for classes and the time that they have to actually take classes. Since the economic environments that we're in right now are so tenuous and so many of our students are living on the edge, we think the students may be more comfortable enrolling in more shorter term courses as they watch how the conditions around them evolve and they have to adapt to them. Vaccines or successful treatments could re-energize people's activities as they move about in today's society. But until that time, we know that many of our students and certainly people who come to the college are indeed playing it safe at college, and we are working each and every day to adapt to those students and certainly to the environment. At the same time, we have to ensure that our operations are fiscally sustainable. And I know that this is something that is important to all of us. As I've shared before, the contraction of our local and state economy is putting tremendous pressure on lots of parts of our society, but certainly in terms of the revenue that the organization receives from the county and state, and certainly, as I spoke earlier, any revenue we might receive from student tuition. So as you consider the spring schedule, I would ask you to think about the fact that we're trying to be much more deliberate in trying to see enrollment as a buffer against some of these changes that are happening to and around us. I'd also like you to think about the fact that we're not making any official changes to the academic calendar. There are processes that I honor each and every year about that. We've also have been very deliberate as a college, and have several programs that already offer robust 7-week classes. And the research is telling us that our students perform better in these classes and they need those courses right now, given their own vulnerability in this moment. We know that these condensed classes for many of our students allows them to have greater focus and certainly allows them to improve their chances of completion. Now, with that in mind, I received an email from a faculty member that I want to share that I really appreciate because I understand there's been lots of formal and informal conversation, and some opportunities where we can to correct or speak to issues I think are really important. And she wrote to me and said this in a very thoughtful way. Dr. Pollard, thank you for your in-depth explanation of the changes to the spring 2021 semester. Very clear, researched, and understandable. Proud of having you at the helm for sure. As one of your English faculty members, this change impacts my ability to serve my students with best practices. However, I will always shift as quickly as life shifts to stay sane and to work efficiently, and I will. In the future, it may be more prudent to include faculty who are on your front lines where somewhere in the process of decision-making. In that way, we will feel abreast or in the know of upcoming changes and feel we are a significant member of the MC family. It hit hard and I felt blindsided after an already stressful summer of SRT, quarantining, and heightened social injustice. Just some food for thought. I really want to thank you for the comments because I receive them and I read them and it means a lot to me that you took the time to share it, and the spirit and tone of that means a great deal to me. Let me share just a couple of reactions to this. You are indeed correct. These are unprecedented times. There are days when I think deeply about why someone does the type of job that I do, but I do it because I believe deeply in this mission that we have, and I work with exceptional people. Sometimes decisions have to be made very quickly, and we don't have time that we would normally do to vet them as deeply within the organization as we would and take the time to do that. But in this case, we did actually vet this decision some within academic affairs, and we had leadership across the table, faculty, staff, and administrators as a part of those conversations. What's interesting is that the spring schedule is developed so far in advance and is done at such a rapid pace that oftentimes is done before many faculty who may be away or doing different work in the summer actually return to faculty meetings that take place in the fall. So our attempt was to actually say, this is the process that we're going to use. This is the eventual outcome. But department chairs and deans and provosts are going to be working deliberately with faculty to figure out, again, what 70% of our classes can be adapted and should be adapted. Most of those courses are, and actually should be, only courses that we've taught in that format before, and what courses simply will not allow for that and will be taught in the traditional 15-week semester. I have a deep and abiding commitment to communication. Like you, I take great pride in how I say things. I take great pride in making sure that I try to respond to members of the college community in very deliberate ways. And I take great pride in trying to make decisions that are deeply informed by members of the college community. So I thank you, Professor, for sharing those perspectives with me. I'm hopeful that the communication I share with you gives some insight. And I'll also take your advice under consideration and certainly hear you in that what we can always improve upon as a college community is communication. I appreciate the fact that you recognize how and why this needs to happen. And like you, I'm going to work on my stress and work on taking care of myself and hope that you'll continue to do the same thing as well, because I know that we all need to do that right now. Now, I realize that this has been a big change for a number of faculty as they think about the spring, and I'm hopeful that by announcing it early, both you and our students will have time to think about its impact and be able to prepare and change for that, and we're going to support you 100% in that. It may take some adaptation, I have no doubt, but this is not the first time that we've had to adapt, and I can guarantee you it will not be the last time. I want to thank all of you for the messages that I've received, both formal and informal. I really want to thank you for the feedback that you solicit and pass to me through different people within the college community. The health and safety of the college community, our students, our faculty, our staff, the people who come to the college on business and so forth, all of those folks are important to me. And they figure prominently in the decisions that I have to make. But more importantly, it's a guiding force for me about how we do this work. I feel fortunate to work with tremendously dedicated people who work each and every day to advance a powerful mission in the community. And more importantly, I hope that each and every one of you is able to get a little bit of rest before we start this all over again, this glorious dance that we do every year when we start the fall semester off. More importantly, be well, take care of yourself, and keep writing to me. I really appreciate it. Take care.